Aurora da Gama, a la edad de 13 años, le dio por vagar descalza por la casa grande y olorosa de sus abuelos durante noches húmedas, y entonces abría las ventanas de par en par. Debido a Aurora, la magnética madre del narrador de la última novela de Salman Rushdie, las moscas zumbaban, dice la novela, a través de las abiertas ventanas de rejilla, y las maleducadas ráfagas a través de las separadas hojas de vidrio emplumado. La apertura de los postigos dejaba entrar todo lo demás, el polvo y el tumulto de los barcos del puerto de Cochín, las sirenas de los cargueros y los resoplidos de los remolcadores, los chistes groseros de los pescadores y la vibración de sus aguijones para las medusas, la luz del sol afilada como un cuchillo, un calor que podía ahogarte, como un trapo húmedo que te envolviera apretadamente la cabeza, los gritos de los flotantes vendedores, las bocanadas de tristeza de los judíos solteros a través de las aguas en Mattencherry, las amenazas de los contrabandistas de esmeraldas, las maquinaciones de los rivales comerciales, el creciente nerviosismo de la colonia británica, las exigencias de dinero contante del personal administrativo y de los trabajadores de las plantaciones de las montañas, los relatos de los alborotos comunistas y políticas de los Wada del Congreso, los nombres de Gandhi y de Nehru, los rumores de hambruna en el este y de huelgas de hambre en el norte, las canciones y tamborileos de los narradores callejeros y el sonido pesadamente retumbante al romper contra el desvencijado embarcadero de la isla de Cabral, de las crecientes mareas de la historia. Así son las novelas de Salman Rushdie. Así son, un poco como este párrafo, un poco como estas ventanas que dejan entrar la historia. Todo pasa por ellas, o podría empezar a pasar por ellas en cualquier momento. Desde luego, las vicisitudes de esta historiada venida a Chile parecen ser un episodio del último suspiro del Moro, su último libro que Rushdie está presentando estos días. Sus novelas son gordas y multifacéticas, fabulosas y divertidas, inteligentes, satíricas y a la vez con momentos de rara ternura. No se parecen a nada, y de repente siento que se parecen a tantas cosas. Su mundo es extraño y al mismo tiempo entrañablemente familiar. Rushdie se ha dado maña para crear un estilo peculiar suyo, a través del cual ha podido dar una imagen de lo inconmensurable, la India de hoy y su historia. Una India que desde sus páginas uno imagina allá lejos y termina encontrando en uno mismo. En esta sala hemos tenido el honor de recibir a grandes escritores como Mario Vargas Llosa, José Donoso, Raúl Zurita, Héctor Aguilar Camín, Antonio Skármeta y otros, varios de los cuales están aquí hoy día. También hemos tenido la oportunidad de conversar aquí con grandes pensadores de la libertad. Pero hoy tenemos entre nosotros a un hombre que en el ejercicio de su libertad creativa, que a causa de una novela, ha sido perseguido y sentenciado por grupos fundamentalistas islámicos. Salman Rushdie con su vida nos ha mostrado qué poder liberador y corrosivo de prejuicios y dogmas puede tener la ficción cuando hay en ella verdadera calidad literaria. Salman Rushdie es un héroe de la libertad cuyo campo de batalla, como Don Quijote, empezó entre las páginas con olor a tinta y ha terminado en la vida real. Solo que sus enemigos no salen solo de su cabeza, sino que de las páginas de otro libro, un libro sagrado, y de verdad buscan su cabeza porque le temen. Por eso ha vivido por años ya, día a día, en situación de riesgo. Salman, gracias por estar hoy con nosotros. Gracias. A continuación, ustedes conocen el formato de la reunión. Es un formato habitual entre nosotros. Va a haber una hora más o menos de conversación con el crítico señor David Gallagher y con posterioridad vamos a ofrecer la palabra a los asistentes para que haya un diálogo con ustedes. Luego, si estamos a tiempo, vamos a ofrecer la oportunidad de que firme algunos libros. La última novela, el último suspiro del Moro, está en venta abajo. Hay un mesón de Sudamericana para eso. Aprovecho la oportunidad de agradecer a Sudamericana y a Plaza Janés el habernos permitido realizar este acto aquí y a las fuerzas de seguridad que lo han autorizado. Gracias. David.
Simon, just picking up on Arturo's comments, I know few writers writing today who are more literary than you are, and you made a tremendous defense of the fictiveness of fiction, of the very particular space that literature has in our lives. And yet, at the same time, paradoxically, there is no writing today which appears to encroach so much on reality, so much that, that we are, in a way, in the last day or two, been living as though part of your novel. On the one hand, you talk about, I've heard you talk about the tremendous autonomy characters have in your work and how a character takes on his own life and his own flight in your work. And yet, in a way, you are yourself as a character in your own fiction. What does it feel like, this kind of duality of being both creator and created and self-created?
I think sometimes it's like my fictional character's revenge on their author. I think any fictional character of mine would tell you that it is a very difficult fate to be in one of my books. They get very badly treated. Very few of them get out alive. They tend to explode and buildings fall on them. Terrible diseases grip them. People come up and slash their faces. Anyway, it's a hard life for a fictional character these days. The work is not as good as it used to be. So I suppose this is a kind of revenge. It used to be. I remember when my novel Midnight's Children was published, which is a book about a boy with a very large and somewhat runny nose, that every single time I had to do a reading from the book, I would develop a cold. And this always felt like his revenge on me. I do think there is one of the reasons we were talking yesterday when we were speaking, one of the reasons for writing in this way always seemed to me that the world in fact was like this. And I guess it's dreadful to be proved right. But I think in fact, the world is like this. The world is not a kind of quiet place anymore. It's not the kind of world of Jane Austen in which you could describe human life as a series of parties and marriages. It's unfortunately a lot stranger than that. And recent events seem to bear this out.
Your work seems to touch a whole area where of debate, which one has in modern society, the respect to the limits of pluralism, the desirability of pluralism on the one hand, the loss, the nostalgia that pluralism leads to, and there are some people who feel that controversially, I think that there definitely are limits to pluralism, and when it comes to this question of respect for other people's beliefs and what the limits of that respect should be. Could you tell us a bit about that, because it's at the center of the controversy?
Well, I think we should just, yes, let's get that out of the way, so to speak. I think it's a significant fact that the First Amendment to the American Constitution safeguards not only freedom of speech, but also freedom of religious expression. In fact, the First Amendment is really about safeguarding the freedom of religious expression, and free speech kind of sneaks in on the back of it. So these two things are very closely linked in the minds of people who have been interested in the free speech issue. And clearly, it's important to safeguard people's freedom of religious expression, whatever that may be. But that is not the same thing as placing a kind of barbed wire fence around their ideas and saying that these cannot be discussed or criticized. That's what I'm saying, I suppose, is that you must protect people's right to believe or not believe and to express that in any way they choose, but that doesn't create a kind of no-go area for inquiry. That's to say, as an idea or as a set of ideas, these are no different to any other set of ideas and are subject to the same rules. The question of offence, see, is a very strange notion to introduce into intellectual discourse, because if that is the rule, one must not offend, then one simply can't speak at all, because everything offends somebody. Plenty of things that religious people say offend me, but that's not the issue. If on the grounds of offence, one would certainly have banned most of the great masterpieces of the 20th century. James Joyce's Ulysses was held to be very offensive to the Catholic Church. It was held to be pornographic at the time. Nabokov's Lolita was held to be, about child molestation, and an extremely nasty book. I mention these not in order to put myself in the same bracket, but because one of the things that most distressed me when the controversy about the Satanic Verses began was that nobody had seemed to have read the book. I, for a time, rather naively believed that the book would be its own best defense. That all these things that people were saying about the book as its author could quite simply be answered with reference to the text itself. And it was very frustrating that that seemed to be the only technique that nobody was using. After a time, I came to feel that I was not alone in this, that it seemed to be quite clear that if you look at the great cases of literary censorship in our time, that in all those cases, the people attacking those works were not readers of those works. In the famous Lady Chatterley trial, the judge, in fact, as part of his instructions to the jury, said to them that they must ask themselves not only whether they would like to read such a book, but whether they would like their wives to read it, whether they would like their children to read it, and whether they would like their servants to read it. So they went away and rather rapidly said yes. it seems almost, I'm quite clear that people had not read Ulysses when they described it as a kind of anti-national book and so on. It's quite clear that the people who attacked Lolita were not familiar with the text of Lolita, this very strange, highly intellectual, very wrought book. So I thought in the end, maybe in order to burn a book, in order to try and assassinate an author, it is necessary not to read the work. It's almost a precondition. Because if you make the mistake of reading a 550-page literary novel, you are obliged to accept that this is quite a complex piece of communication. And it can't be reduced to a slogan of the sort that people mean when they say it is an insult. You know, it would not have taken me 550 pages and 5 years of my life to insult somebody. I could do that much faster. So this wasn't the purpose. Although it may be, I mean, I accept it may be an effect, right? Because insult can be taken when it's not given. You know, it can be taken when it is not intended. And to be serious about it, I think that even there are people who did read the Satanic Verses who did not like it and were very angry about it. And I suppose how I would describe that problem is as follows, that there is in the Satanic Verses a dispute about the nature of, about the status of sacred texts and stories. And clearly, if you believe that those texts and stories are beyond dispute, then you don't like the fact that somebody disputes it. I mean, that's inevitable. I was very interested in the phenomenon of revelation and how it comes about, but my view about it is not that of a formally religious person. So naturally, there is a strong disagreement. The story of how the Quran was first revealed to the Prophet Muhammad tells us that when he stood on top of this mountain, Mount Hira, outside Mecca, he saw the Archangel Gabriel standing on the horizon, so huge that he filled the sky, and ordering him to recite, and then telling him the what I call the uncreated words of God. Now, if I were asked, and I asked myself the question, that had I been standing next to the Prophet Muhammad at this moment, would I have seen the Archangel? Mm-hmm. And I'm obliged to answer that in my view I would not. At the same time, it's also quite clear that the Prophet is not making it up. That's to say, this is not simply something he's fictionalized. And this paradox, that he saw something and I would not have seen it, but yet he sincerely saw it, is something which needs to be explored and resolved, I thought. And since my method of exploring and resolving these things is by telling stories, by trying to create a character who I can believe and trying to get inside his head and trying to show how it might have been true for him, that's how I began to do it. Now, clearly, if you think these matters are beyond argument and there simply was an angel on the horizon filling the sky and reciting the uncreated words of God, then you don't like the fact that somebody says there might be another way of looking at this. But actually, there might be another way of looking at this. And that's the serious, the kind of basis of the dissent, I think. It has to do with what one could call a quarrel about language. Who tells these stories? Who has the power over these stories? And in what language can these stories be told? That's to say, can they only be told in sacred and reverential language in the form that exists in the sacred books? Or can they be told in the irreverent, if you like, blasphemous language of the novel? The novel is not a reverent form. Nobody can write, in my view, a good novel that is reverent. So the form itself requires that you take a different attitude towards your material. And so, as one of the characters in the novel says when he worries about the Prophet's revenge upon him, he says, it's his word against mine. And I guess that this has been, at its most profound level, I think, a quarrel about language.
So let's talk about your work and your life when you were just before Satanic Verses, when you were just one of the two or three finest novelists writing in England. Tell us about this sort of bicultural nature of yourself, as it were, brought up in Bombay, school in England, what it has meant to you, because it comes across an enormous amount in your novels.
Yeah, well, the mixture of cultures, I should say, existed before I ever came to England. because I grew up in Bombay in the 1950s. This was immediately after the independence of India. And of course the influence of the British was very much there at that time, because these things don't end abruptly on Independence Day. And in common with almost everybody else in the Indian middle classes, I was sent to a school in which the medium of instruction was English. Almost all the bourgeoisie, so to speak, in India, sends their children to what are basically mission foundation schools, which were founded during the imperial period and are the kind of best schools in the country. The state schools are of a very much lower standard of education and really don't get much further than reading and writing and basic arithmetic. So from the from the beginning of my education, the language of instruction was English. So I was immediately turned into a bicultural entity at that point, that there would be a language spoken at home and another language spoken at school. It's also a kind of commonplace in India that most people speak many languages, and that these languages get mixed up with each other. So that a sentence might well begin in one language, continue through a second language, and end in a third, in a way that one is not even conscious of. Simply, if the most appropriate phrase is in a given language, you use that language. And this is, of course, particularly true in large conglomerate metropolitan areas like the city, where people speaking many different languages assemble, and those languages collide with each other. So, I mean, one of my problems as a writer was that if I wanted to try and write down the way in which my characters would really speak, it would be more or less incomprehensible, because one would need to be speaking all those languages. So I had to try and invent a kind of English which sounded like that conglomeration of languages, without actually being that conglomeration. That seemed to me the only way of setting down this kind of composite music that was in my head long before I came to England, and in which English rhythms were already a part. I mean, Bombay is a strange city, because it's a city whose history acquires the quality of metaphor rather rapidly. Bombay didn't exist before the British went to India. There was no city there. There was a rather beautiful natural harbour, and there were some fishing villages, that's all. The Portuguese, in fact, conquered that area first. And the way the English got it is rather strange. It is because the Portuguese succeeded in making a marriage between Princess Catherine of Braganza of Portugal and Charles II of England. Unfortunately, Princess Catherine was very ugly, and it became necessary to offer inducements of a fairly generous nature. The British had identified the harbour of Bombay as something that would be very useful as a base for their fleet. And so they negotiated that Bombay should come to them as part of the wedding settlement, as part of the dowry. So it started off as this kind of wedding present. And immediately the British set about land reclamation, because at that point the harbour contained a group of islands and there were breaches in the harbour wall. And so basically the British literally pulled from out of the sea a lot of the land on which they then built the city. So this is a city built on reclaimed land, and built by the British, not by the Indians. And so it's a rather extraordinary colonial legacy in that sense. Now, of course, it is, as I've said in the novel, the most Indian of Indian cities. And the reason for that is also geographical. It has not to do with the harbour, but to put it simply, everything to the north of Bombay is North India. Everything to the south of Bombay is South India. Everything to the east of Bombay is the east, and to the west of Bombay is the west. You know, so it stands at this extraordinary crossroads of all the different kinds of India. and also between India and the West. So, so this makes it, to my mind, the most extraordinary, one of the most extraordinary cities I've ever seen, and a polyglot and a jumbled city in a way that no other Indian city really is, because Calcutta, for instance, a very great city, is mostly culturally homogeneous. It's mostly Bengali people. Madras is mostly Tamil people in the south. Delhi is mostly North Indian people. Bombay is everybody, because it's being the great industrial city and being the great port, it attracts people from all over the country. So this kind of cosmopolitan element, this polyglot element, was present in around me from the moment I was born. And so it isn't so much a question that I grew up in the East and then went to the West and had to find some kind of synthesis between the two. It's more that I already found all those things present in the place I was growing up. And then, of course, I found the East extremely present in the West when I got there. Because, after all, I'm not the only person of Indian extraction settled in India. And that community, that diaspora of India, but around the world now, has become one of the most fascinating subjects to me. Indians get very confused. You know, people from India come to England and they go to Indian communities settled in England, and they get very puzzled. The people are dressing in the wrong way. You know, they're behaving strangely, and they don't seem to Indians from India to be very like Indians at all. You know, and yet, they insist on being Indians. And it is something which I've had to quite often say when I've been in India, that Indians in India must now accept that the way in which people can be Indians has become very varied. You know, they in India have to accept that these are also, sort of, as it were, authentic ways of being Indian, even though they take place in, you know, in Bradford or in America, wherever it may be. So what I'm saying is, it's never been an artificially constructed thing to try and write about a fusion between the East and the West. It simply is something I've never been able to escape.
You make the comment in the Moore's Last Side that it's very easy to be the wrong kind of Indian. In India itself, of the wrong turban or the wrong.
Yes, people get killed. People get killed for being slightly wrong. Right. One of the most extraordinary aspects of the partition riots and the great massacres between Hindus and Muslims that took place then, is that people were asked to take their trousers down to see if they were circumcised or not, because Muslims are and Hindus aren't. So that if you happen to be asked by the wrong person and you had the wrong kind of penis, that was basically it. So people were being killed for, you know, this is clearly something which would be funny if it was not horrible. But these slight variations have been lethal, you know, in India. So there is also now, I think, a very strange idea gaining force in India. That's one of the reasons, one of the things that this book was somewhat written against. The idea that only the experience of the Hindu majority is in some way authentic Indian experience, and that everybody else is somehow there by permission. Now, it is true that the Hindu majority represents 85% of the population, but 15% of 900 million people is a lot of people. and to have their experience somehow declared to be untrue, you know, inauthentic, is clearly very dangerous thing. So I thought what I would do in this book is to stand this proposition on its head, and to take two of the very smallest communities in India, the very small South Indian Jewish community, and the somewhat larger but still small South Indian Catholic community, and then to create an even smaller minority by having an intermarriage between them, which, you know, really almost never happens. So then there is a Christian-Jewish family, which becomes almost a minority of one. And I thought that what I would do, having set up this tiny and apparently very marginal community, would be to move it to the center of the frame, you know, instead of at the margin, and to show that you could in fact grow the whole country out of it quite easily, and that the experience of such a family and such people would be just as Indian, just as interesting, just as ingrained in that country as anybody else's experience. So it was just at one level a way of just reversing a kind of political idea that I thought was rather an unpleasant one. Also, I mean, these are very strange and unusual communities, and they're very interesting to write about in their own terms, because they arrived in South India, I mean, many thousands of years ago. The Jewish community in South India is so unusual that its practice diverges from Jewish orthodoxy so much that when, after the foundation of the State of Israel, a lot of the young people from South India went to settle in Israel, they had quite a lot of difficulty in Israel because their way of observing their religion was such that a lot of people said they weren't Jews at all. I mean, they don't have rabbis, for example. And that in many other ways are different. I mean, similarly, the Catholic or the Christian Church in South India has been a really quite extraordinary story. I mean, the legend is that St. Thomas the Apostle went to India and founded a Christian church there. We call it, you know, the Church of Doubting Thomas, you know, would be a kind of Christianity of uncertainty. But they then developed rather rapidly a whole series of variant forms of Christianity there. There is a Syriac Christianity in South India, which has a lot of adherents, and even Nestorian Christianity, which the Catholic Church now says is not really Christianity, must not be counted Christianity. And there continues to be a great fight between them, you know, for disciples and so on, followers. These days, the Catholic Church is certainly winning, because they're putting a lot of money into it, you know, and so gradually the Catholic Church is attracting converts from the others. But there is this really very little known and extremely unusual world, to which I was also drawn for one other reason, which has to do with the spice trade. And I remember being in South India in Cochin, standing by the grave of Vasco da Gama. I should say the empty grave of Vasco da Gama, because although he died there, he only stayed in his grave for 14 years, and then was taken back to Lisbon and put in a different tomb, rather grander. So the Indian Tourist Office, in all its literature, will say, if you go to Cochin, you must see the grave of Vasco da Gama, but it doesn't tell you that he's not inside. anyway, standing beside the grave of Vasco, who had managed to leave the country even though he was dead. It struck me that this was, after all, that he was the representative of the first contact between Europe and India, and that the whole reason for the cultural connection was initially pepper and spices, but particularly pepper. And it occurred to me that if it had not been for this tiny little thing, this grain of pepper, there might never have been this kind of historical connection in the way that it developed. And so if the whole history of the West's relationship with India, you could say, grew out of a grain of pepper, I thought it would also be interesting to grow a novel out of it, to start with this thing. As it's said very early in the novel, the narrator says, to begin with, pass the pepper. And I thought that we would just start with that. Now, it is true historically that the Christian and Jewish communities in South India were very active in the spice trade. So that gave me another natural reason for starting there. So this is a novel that grows out of a peppercorn.
How does looking from east to west, I mean, how... When you're wearing your Bombay eyes, as it were, I mean, how does England look? I mean, in satanic verses, some horrific, I think, quite plausible scenes in which immigration police don't come out everywhere. Mm. And in the Moore's Last Sigh, although it's not England, there's this sort of wonderful end when Moraes arrives in Spain and gets to Benin Kelly, which readers of Cervantes will recognize as a very special town, and finds everything so strange, and you know, can't understand how things work. And
well, I just thought that this is, you know, that there is a commonplace about novels that Western writers write about the East, that they go to the East and they find it very strange, and it's extremely exotic, and they don't know how anything works or why people behave in certain ways, and it all seems rather strange and mysterious to them. And I thought it would be enjoyable to write a book in which the East was the completely familiar and known and comprehended and logical, reasonable world, and then he catches a plane to Spain and everything goes crazy. You know? Suddenly he finds himself in a world he doesn't understand. I wanted the West in this book to be the mysterious place, you know, to be the strange and somewhat spooky place in which you didn't understand the rules of the world, and when you discovered what those rules were, they were very dangerous to you. They were possibly lethal. The Spain in the novel, I mean, is somewhat based on the fact that I have been many times to Andalusia. In particular, there are some towns there which have become places to which expatriates from the rest of the world tend to go and settle. And there's a version of that kind of rather degraded expatriate community in this novel, moving up and down what the village calls the Street of the Parasites, a street which is entirely composed of Gucci handbag shops and kind of Gap clothing stores and Danish meatball restaurants and so on, and not a single Spaniard, you know, ever walks down it. But there are plenty of Norwegians and Canadians and Japanese people, and the rest of the village just leaves them alone. They live there in this little microcosm. Given that I've spent a lot of my life writing about migration and the kind of richnesses that it permits, I thought it would be quite interesting to talk about a rather barren variation of migration. I remember meeting people in towns like this whose politics were fairly incredible. I remember one woman had just left Portugal at the end of the dictatorship because she disapproved of the end of the dictatorship and was now lamenting her arrival in Spain because no sooner had she settled in Spain than the dictator Franco had unfortunately died. So she said she was looking for a good dictatorship to migrate to. And she had seriously considered Nicaragua, but then the Somozas had fallen. You know, it was really getting difficult for her to find a place to live. These are the kinds of people who settle in these strange expatriate communities. So people who would boast about their lifelong habit of destroying trade unions and breaking strikes and so on. I have wanted to satirize this particular community for a long time. So a part of the book comes naturalistically out of that. But as I was endlessly having to explain to people in Spain recently, there is an aspect of this novel that is not naturalistically about Spain. In fact, anybody who knows the geography of Andalusia will notice that where Benengue, the village of Benengue, is placed is more or less geographically impossible. Let's say the mountains have been somewhat twisted around and moved into the wrong place. And indeed, the real-life location of the so-called place where the Sultan Boabdil looked back at Granada for the last time, Suspiro del Moro, the real-life Suspiro del Moro is not really very like the place in the book. And this was done quite deliberately, because the Spain in this novel is a Spain of ghosts. It's a Spain of ghosts and insanity. And that was one reason why Don Quixote was very useful, because, I mean, one of the things perhaps not enough said about Don Quixote is that it's a book about madness. It's a book about, seriously about madness, and about philosophical aspects of madness derived from Erasmus and so on. And since in that part of the novel is also about madness, it seemed, and it's in Spain, it seemed proper to make some homage to Quixote. And the reason that the village in the novel is called Benengeli is because, after all, Cervantes himself, paying homage to the kind of, if you like, the kind of Arab source of these fantastic tales, the sort that he was telling, you know, pretended that his novel was narrated by a Moor. So, so I decided to bring the Moor back, if you like, for a few more laughs.
What other literary roots do you identify with? Obviously, people have compared you to Garcia Marquez, but that's probably coincidental, probably because some.
Well, I admire Garcia Marquez, and I think he's a very great writer. I think, like most writers, I am a very big reader. I think that's, it is I think, the case with writers, that writers read very, very widely. And so the roots come from, or the things that that ring bells in your head can come from almost anywhere. And in my case, I have been for a long time very interested in Latin American literature, which increasingly is available in good translations and so on, which at the time that I first became interested in it, it really was not. You had to really go hunting for these books. But for me, the real revelation when I was still a university student was Borges. Nobody knew, this was, I'm talking about in the middle 1960s, nobody knew who Borges was, or so I thought. I had this sense of Borges being a kind of private pleasure that was known only to me and maybe 20 or 30 other people. And then he came to England to give a series of lectures and filled a hall of 1,500 people five nights running. and it suddenly struck me that it was clear that one or two other people knew about him, which was rather disappointing. You know? I mean, there are Calvino has a wonderful essay about his writing in which he said that he had begun naturalistically and then had decided that he did not want to write those books. That the books he would like to write are the sort that you might discover by accident while rummaging in the attic in your great aunt's house. You open a trunk and there are some strange books in there. He said those are the books that he would like to write, the ones that nobody has ever heard of and nobody ever knows. I had that sense about Borges, you see. I seemed to have come across him while rummaging in a trunk. It was very disappointing to discover that he was one of the world's most famous writers. But certainly, Borges, and after that, I have read quite a lot. I mean, I think, for instance, in this novel, there is a little echo of Juan Rulfo also, because there is, of course, in Pedro Páramo, there is a kind of haunted village, differently haunted and for different reasons than in my book, but a certain ghostly atmosphere in my novel, I think, probably owes a little bit to Rulfo. I mean, Garcia Marquez, I don't know. You know, this I've always dumped in this basket. And as I say, it's very flattering in a way, because I think he is one of the very greatest writers in the world, if not the greatest writer in the world. But I think there are great differences between us, which, I mean, to put it at its simplest, I think, has to do with the city versus the country. You know, that, I would have said that everything I've ever written is a book that are books that arise out of a kind of metropolitan sensibility. I'm a big city boy, maybe. And it's always seemed to me that the particular magic of Garcia Marquez has to do with a focus on the village as the center rather than the city, if you like, a kind of privileging of the world view of the village above the worldview of the city. So that in Garcia Marquez, if a miracle happens and a girl who is too good for this world floats up into the sky, this is perfectly normal, you know, and everybody says, she always was like that, and we always expected something funny to happen to her. But if the railway train arrives in town, everybody screams and goes mad, you know, because that is really peculiar. There's a wonderful description of the railway train arriving for the first time
in Macondo, in which a woman comes running, screaming through the streets, and people stop her and say, "What is going on?" And she says, "Something's coming. It's something terrible." She says, "I don't know what it is. It's like a kitchen dragging a village behind it." And this, I mean, of course, is a measure of Garcia Marquez's genius that he can come up with such an image. But I think it's indicative of the fact that in his world, the world of the city, of machines, you know, of industry, of metropolitan life, is what is, that's what's really fantastic. You know, whereas these strange, ignorant, miracle-ridden villages are the truth, you know, as far as he's concerned. And so in that sense, I think in a way we're opposite writers in our sensibilities. Anyway.
I think what I'd like to give a lot of people a chance to make the questions. I'd just like to make one comment before doing that. When Arturo Fontaine and I were coming back from talking to you yesterday, you know, we were sort of reflecting that that all the problems that you've had in these last few years seem to have been for being the sort of person that all of us would like to be, or all of us are, but you articulated better. But I mean, just you know, open-minded, civilized, literary, rational, irrational sometimes, just you know, terribly civilized modern human being, and yet this brought about this extraordinary sort of sentence is our sort of rather liberal kind of way of life or view of the world getting really under threat. I mean, is it getting more difficult to be like that in the world, do you think?
Yeah, I think it is. I think it is. I think it always was. You know, I think the illusion of civilization is that it's somehow here to stay, but actually it keeps disappearing, and all over the place. You know, and actually, one of the things that I have been thinking about for years, and not just in this novel, but it is one of the things I think at the darker side of this novel, is the question of not absolving ourselves from responsibility for the barbaric things that human beings do. That's to say, if you say that so-and-so, oh well, he's just a monster, or he's an animal, so, you know, one uses these phrases about people who commit atrocities, and that somehow, it's a way of describing them as belonging to a different species than ourselves. Of course, we wouldn't do things like that, is the kind of implicit in that. And it struck me that that was a kind of improper response. And that what was, because in fact, perhaps, if we were provoked in the right way, or pushed in the wrong direction, maybe we would do things like that. And one of the things that that provoked these thoughts was that in India, in recent years, there's been a series of extraordinary moments of atrocity, of a kind that I would describe as intimate violence, you know, where communities would kill their neighbors, that you would for whatever reason, slaughter the people whose children had been playing with your children the day before. You would indeed slaughter the children. And you knew these people, you know, that you could walk down a street in Old Delhi where people were living and working and laughing perfectly happily amongst each other one day, and the next day the streets were running with those same people's blood as they killed each other. Now, I mean, you could say that what the events in Bosnia and so on are a reflection of this also, this kind of not a violence between strangers, but a violence between people who intimately know each other. And you wonder how this is possible. Where does it come from? You know? And I think what I could come up with was a fairly let's say, bleak view, which is that it may well be that that is what we're like, and that civilization is the aberration. That actually that is our nature, and that civilization is a thing that we create in order to prevent us from behaving like that. And if we're lucky, it works. But that other thing, you know, is always there. It's always there, and this is not just a question of India. It's always there everywhere. And I don't need to tell people in Latin America how fragile civilization can be, and how rapidly it can that this kind of this other force can burst through that veneer. So yeah, I mean, I think there is around the world a threat to these liberal ideas at the moment. But on the other hand, I think there always was.
Mm-hmm.
Héctor, tú vas a pasar el micrófono. Y es importante que ahora funcione la traducción para saber. Vi una mano por ahí, no alcanzo a ver quién es.
Ana María la Reina. Hola. Quiero hacer una pregunta. El narrador suyo dice en el libro del Moro: después de una vida no tan larga, siento que estoy libre de tesis. La vida misma es una crucifixión suficiente. Me gustaría preguntarle si usted hasta qué punto participa de esta experiencia del narrador, cómo ha ido, y de ser así, cómo ha ido evolucionando esta experiencia, desde la tesis, tal vez a la libertad. Y bueno, ¿y de qué manera o por qué lo ha cambiado?
Well, I think the question about how closely central character in a novel corresponds to the author is one that always makes writers defensive. because, of course, what all writers would say is that it's nothing to do with me, and that would always be a lie. But the opposite is also not true. The fact is that this character is not me. But the moment you choose a character who is the point of view character in the novel, then of course something of your own point of view comes through that. I mean, how could it not? Why would you do it otherwise? So, you know, in the way that to use some great analogies, in the way that Marcel is not Proust, you know, in the way that Stephen Dedalus is not James Joyce, but they're pretty close. I suppose that he's not me, but he shares certain of my ideas anyway. Once again, being a character in one of my novels, he has a very bad time. there are certain aspects of his life which, I mean, I can't deny have some would not be as they are if things had not happened to me as they had. So there is, for instance, a passage in the novel which has already started being quoted a great deal, and I sort of knew it would be. Which is a passage about fear, in which he talks about the nature of fear and how you overcome it, and he says more or less that the way in which people overcome fear is because they have no time for it, and they have to get on with their lives. And I mean, quite clearly, something about my views is present in that. But it's not only my views, because one of the places that came from was a meeting or an encounter I had with some writers and intellectuals from Sarajevo a few years ago. And they were living in a situation where every time they crossed a street, they ran the risk of a sniper's bullet. And they all said this thing, this very similar thing, that in order to function at all, they simply had to set aside the issue of fear. It ceased to be a relevant thing. And when they were telling me this, I felt that there was that was quite accurately the way in which I felt as well. So in an instance like that, when he talks about how he overcomes his fears, I mean, then certainly that has a great deal to do with what happened to me. But as a person, I think he's not very like me. At least I hope not, because he spends rather a lot of the book being extremely violent and beating people up. And although there are many people that I would quite like to beat up, so far I've not done so.
Raúl Zurita, Raúl is a very important Chilean poet.
Señor Rushdie. No, solamente quería expresarle un sentimiento de gratitud que va más allá de cualquier palabra de agradecimiento que uno le podría hacer. Es tremendamente paradojal, ¿cierto?, que el hecho de leer sus libros, de leer los versos satánicos, a mí me ha hecho más amplio, más generoso y fundamentalmente más libre. Y probablemente, ¿cierto?, el ejercicio de la literatura sea siempre el de hacer más libre a quien lee. No puedo dejar de emocionarme de la oportunidad de poder decírselo, que es doloroso y es una ironía extremadamente cruel que esa libertad que yo he ganado haya sido, en cierto sentido, a costa de la suya. Es muy fuerte. Uno pocas veces en este mundo y en esta vida tiene la oportunidad de decirle a los autores lo que sus libros realmente han significado. Y esto es por una razón bastante simple, porque esos libros están repartidos entre 1000 años de historia. Y la mayoría de la gente que uno quisiera decirle, mira, tu libro significó eso para mí, bueno, está muerta. Entonces, se lo digo con todo, como decía, con todo mi sentimiento de gratitud, que va más allá de lo que incluso en este momento pueda decir. Eso.
You know, there can be few finer rewards for a writer than to hear such words. So, I mean, this is why we write, you know, in order to, I mean, when you write a book, you dream, perhaps, that one day somebody will say to you things like this. Because nobody does. Because the things you dream about are so extreme that nobody would ever say them. So it's very, I mean, it's really wonderful to hear it said. I must say that for all the difficulties that were caused for me by the Satanic Verses, there were some extraordinary rewards in terms of the passion with which people responded to the book, when they did. I remember one of the letters I received that I have always remembered quite soon after the trouble began was actually a letter from a young Muslim woman living in Switzerland who was too nervous to do anything except put her first name, you know, and no address and so forth. And, but she said, she used a kind of a metaphor in which she said, supposing that somebody that you love has been taken prisoner and is being held in a room by people with guns, you know. And she said, and people arrive to rescue the person. She said, somebody has to kick the door down. You know, and whoever kicks the door down gets all the bullets. But after that, the door has been kicked down. and it becomes easier for other people to go through. And she said, you know, I feel very grateful to you, but also very sorry for you because you're the guy who kicked the door down. And I mean, I thought it was probably the nicest letter I ever received, really. Because it showed that at a time when, you know, when people were saying how what a vile individual I was and how, you know, 1 billion people around the planet hated my guts, it was very important to discover that that, or to have it said that that was very far from the truth. And since then I've received, I don't know, many, many letters from around the world, from the Muslim world, I mean, leaving aside non-Muslim, but just from inside the Muslim world, of people who endlessly write to me to say, don't believe that everybody is not on your side, because in fact everybody is on your side. And it just happens to be that there's this kind of gang of terrorists in power in various countries. But one must not make the mistake of, I don't have to say this here, but I'll say it anyway, one must not make the mistake of confusing the dictator with the people. And so these things have been important. It is very comforting to feel that the Satanic Verses is an important book for people in precisely those countries in which the received wisdom is that they're not interested in it. That in fact the opposite is the case. So far so good. Anyway.
Martin Oppenheim, the philosopher and critic.
Sí. Antes que usted entrara a esta sala, algunos de nosotros nos preguntábamos a la hora de hacer preguntas si preguntar sobre política o sobre literatura. Y yo voy a hacer una pregunta que espero. ¿Está bien? Espero sea un punto de encuentro entre las dos cosas. Usted mencionó Quijote, mencionó Borges. Lo que tienen en común, o lo primero que me salta a la vista del Quijote, de Borges, y que tiene que ver también con la forma en que usted de alguna manera se para frente a la literatura, es este narrador que siempre es otro. Este narrador que desaparece, que es típicamente Merengele, o que en Borges siempre es un pergamino que apareció en alguna parte, encontrado por ahí, y no es Borges. Hay un narrador que se borra, que desaparece. Desde que usted llegó a Chile hace un par de días, yo he tenido la misma sensación. Digamos, el escritor nunca aparece, no se sabe dónde está. Me imagino que usted lleva años en este oficio de desaparecer, ¿no? Algo que obviamente no ha elegido. Pero yo me preguntaba, en una ironía que puede ser un poco cruel, puede ser un poco dramática, pero sin pretensión de ofenderlo, ¿no? Estas vueltas que tiene la vida y la literatura, o la política y la literatura, que hacen que en su vida usted tenga que ejercer esa especie como de dura práctica de borrarse a sí mismo, así como eso ha sido elegido por Borges, o por Cervantes, o por usted mismo en la práctica literaria.
Well, I think the truthful answer is that other people have been trying to rub me out. I have been trying not to be erased. As for invisibility, I've always been against it myself. You know, I think that I was always, I mean, in a way, differently than the what you say about Borges and Cervantes. If there was a criticism made of my writing, it was sometimes that I was too present in it. You know, that people would say that. I remember in my third novel, Shame, I used a technique in which I deliberately inserted some non-fiction essayistic passages in which the authorial voice would directly discuss certain public issues and attitudes, and that this would be simply set against the fiction. And I remember that many critics found this very, very, very annoying. They did not want the author to talk to them directly in a novel. It was considered to be something improper. Whereas it struck me that if we were telling each other, if we were sitting in a room and telling each other stories, it would be completely natural that we would comment on the stories. You know, that you, if you have an extraordinary story to tell, you would endlessly offer your opinion on it. You would say, well, wasn't she crazy, or whatever it might be. I don't know why this particular phrase came to mind. But so the fact that the storyteller comments on the story is a completely natural aspect of the way everybody tells stories. And yet, somehow, one of the ground rules of the novel has been classically that you don't do that. You know? So, in a way, I've been deliberately at times excessively visible as a writer. As to the invisibility of real life, one of the paradoxes of that is it takes hundreds of people to achieve it. And this is an invisibility created with the aid of motorcades, sirens, you know, the most visible things in the world are used in order to create invisibility. I remember the first time I went to the United States, the police there overreacted in this way. And I found myself in a 13-vehicle motorcade, in a white Mercedes limousine. with motorcycle outriders and, you know, snipers on the roofs, etc. I said to the police officer who was in charge of the operation, I said, look, you know, if this is a very large operation, you know, and he said, yes, he said, this is what we would do for Arafat. So at this point, I understood what it is like to be Yasser Arafat, at least in New York. And I then said, well, but if this is what you would do for Arafat, what would you do, say, for the President of the United States? And he said, oh, well, for the President of the United States, we'd close down all of these roads here, but in your case, we didn't do that because we thought it would look too conspicuous. Completely serious. You know. So here we have inconspicuousness, you know, in a white Mercedes limousine with a 13-vehicle motorcade. That's what it takes, you know, to make somebody invisible. It's quite, in a way, it's quite flattering. You know, it says a lot about how hard people are to make invisible. You know, that it requires an enormous apparatus to do it. I mean, sometimes these apparatuses are called jails. But motorcades are also, you know, apparatuses of invisibility. I must say, I, in the same way as in my books, I was saying I tried to fight against, if you like, the idea of the invisible writer. I find myself having to do it in other ways too.
Jaime Valdivieso, I'm the writer and critic.
A mí me surge la idea, en el caso de Samuel Ruskin, de que a través de él hay una perspectiva, digamos, la labor del escritor se vuelve esperanzadora y optimista, porque hasta hace poco tiempo atrás, cuando había un exceso de politización, ¿no?, y de contingencialismo en la literatura, se planteaba el hecho de que la literatura, en realidad, los escritores pensaban que podían influir mucho en la sociedad y realmente no influían nada. Y yo creo que en el caso de Ruskin vuelve a replantearse el problema de que el escritor, sin ser necesariamente un político, pero su sola literatura tiene un carácter de potencialidad, de transgresión, de que en sí misma produce una oleada, por así decirlo, de resonancia muy importante para despertar a la gente y a que asuman una actitud. Entonces, en ese sentido, la labor del escritor a través de Lucien vuelve a ocupar un puesto muy importante en un momento en que se creía que el escritor en realidad no significa mayormente nada, sus opiniones van a seguir de largo y van a pasar. Pero yo quisiera referirme a otra cosa que sí me parece muy importante, sobre todo para Chile. Ayer, anoche, en una entrevista que le hiciera Patricia Pollitzer, Pushkin dijo que el recordar, el hecho de recordar, tenía implicaciones políticas. Yo creo que en este país, afortunadamente, la mayoría, no todos, pero la mayoría creemos que recordar y la memoria es importante, sobre todo en el caso de Chile. Y yo creo que una persona pierde la memoria, pierde su identidad, y un país que no quiere recordar también está al borde de perder una parte muy importante de su historia. Yo quisiera que él elaborara un poco sobre el sentido de la importancia del recuerdo. Para un escritor, que es una materia, ¿no es cierto?, insustituible, es su materia prima el recuerdo, pero también lo que significa el recuerdo para un país.
The famous line of Milan Kundera, which I'm sure you, many of you will know, in one of his novels, he says that the struggle of man against power is the struggle of memory against forgetting. And he tells this extraordinary story, this is the Book of Laughter and Forgetting, about a Communist Party photograph in Czechoslovakia. A photograph of the great May Day parade where the party Politburo is standing on the balcony and waving. And because it is a cold day, the chairman has forgotten his hat. One of the other party leaders lends him his hat. So in this photograph, the party leader is wearing one of the other Politburo leaders' hat. And then there arises the unusual, unfortunate case that this particular party member falls from grace. And so this photograph is treated in the laboratory, and the figure of this party leader is airbrushed out of the photograph. So there is only an empty space where he used to stand. And the only proof that he ever existed is the hat, which is on the Politburo leader's head. And if it were not for the hat, he would have been completely erased from history. I think that it was a surprise to me to discover this thing that I said to on television last night, because it's very strange to discover that person's private memories can become, as it were, illegal. Because officially they couldn't possibly be true, or if they were true, many other things would also be true which are not permitted to be true. So that, for example, in 1971 in Bangladesh, there was a war of liberation, basically, took place there, and when the Indian Army joined in and completed the process of liberating Bangladesh from the military rule from what was then West Pakistan. Incredible genocidal atrocities were discovered. The deliberate mass murder of intellectuals whose bodies were found in shallow graves. The deliberate burning of bazaar areas, which were very overcrowded, so that many, many poor people were killed. The deliberate destruction of trades union offices and the assassination of their leaders, so on and so on and so on. I mean, a large-scale, deliberate genocide in which particular groups have been targeted and murdered. Unfortunately, Pakistan immediately began to behave as if this had never happened, began to deny this, had claimed that this was Indian propaganda and so on and so on. Even though there was evidence which was so massive that it really was not arguable. I mean, there were large numbers of eyewitness reports, and there was large amount of photographic evidence, etc. However, not only the generals in Pakistan, but actually large sections of the intelligentsia began to say that this was a kind of attack on their country, and that this had never happened. So I found myself in this position of knowing it had happened, but to say so became something which would actually be very controversial. That people would say that I was the one doing the lying, because it was no longer the official truth that this had happened. Similarly, two or three years after this in India, when Mrs. Gandhi declared a state of dictatorship for some years, really very dreadful things happened in that period, in which sterilization was used as a political weapon, and so on. When Mrs. Gandhi was deposed, because she made the mistake of holding a general election thinking she would win, and did not win, there was something like a 48-hour period when she, between her losing the election and her deciding to leave the Prime Minister's residence, and during this period, everybody in Delhi will tell you that there was a very large column of smoke rising from the back garden, and an enormous quantity of documents were destroyed in that period. And as a result of this destruction of documents, it became more or less impossible ever to bring her up on charges, of which, in my view, she was obviously guilty. But then, it became a kind of truism some years later when she returned to power, that the atrocities of the emergency had not taken place, that nobody had been sterilized or castrated or tortured or etc., etc. So once again, there were many people, not just me, there were many, many people who remembered these things. There were the people to whom it had been done who remembered these things. And it became difficult for them to say so. It became, in a way, subversive or anti-national to say so. And so I found myself, when writing Midnight's Children, and later when writing Shame, which is more directly about Pakistan than India, that I found myself obliged to do what would be taken as a political act, although in fact the intention was more historical than political. It was more to do with remembering and recording than wishing to enter into a controversy. There was simply no way of not entering the controversy. Well, that continues, you know. I mean, in a strange way, I thought The Satanic Verses was the least political novel I wrote. That turned out not to be the case. And in every book I've written, there's more or less been some desire to take on an official version of truth, in order to say that there is another way of seeing this, you know, which has to do with remembering rather than official versions. And so it creates an extraordinary paradox that that those who possess power become the creators of fictions. And those who are the creators of fictions end up having to tell the truth. and so there's a bizarre inversion of roles that takes place.
Thank you. Carlos Iturra.
Señor Rasti, habría desde luego tantos temas que sería interesante aprovechar esta ocasión única de preguntárselo. A mí me interesaría saber, por ejemplo, de qué manera se siente usted afectado por el hecho de estar constituido verdaderamente más en una noticia internacional, diríamos, que en una noticia literaria. Es decir, de qué manera se siente usted afectada la recepción crítica de su obra por este fenómeno descomunal de la condena de los ayatolas, ¿no? También me habría gustado, con relación a Cervantes y al narrador en la presencia de su obra, pedirle su opinión sobre el Ancho Mar de los Sargazos, de Jim Rhys, Wild Sargasso Sea, donde ocurre un fenómeno semejante. Pero de los temas, creo que en la necesidad de optar me quedo con uno. Usted es del Islam, ¿cómo percibe el problema de la tolerancia o de la intolerancia en otras religiones, en otras culturas? Particularmente, ¿cómo percibe que se da ese índice en el cristianismo, concretamente en el catolicismo.
The issue of intolerance, I don't know. The problem is that I've had a rather dramatic personal lesson in the intolerance of Islam. And this inevitably colors my thinking a little bit. At the same time, I've spent my life knowing and growing up amongst Muslims of all sorts. I mean, after all, I come from a Muslim family. So it's impossible for me to make any kind of general statement about the tolerance or intolerance of Islam. What I think is, I think two things. First of all, that many Muslim societies have currently, unfortunately, seen the rise of extremely intolerant political movements which disguise themselves as religious movements. The phenomenon that we call Islamic fundamentalism is not a religious phenomenon. Theologically, it is of no interest whatsoever. It's crude and banal. Its meaning is entirely political. Its purpose is political, and I think they would say so themselves, that they are not, as it were, propounding a new view of the religion. They are trying to seize control of the state, and in some cases succeed in doing so. So I think, you know, in every culture there are instances of political movements using religious clothing. And the phenomenon of Islamic fundamentalism, I think, is the Islamic version of that. However, I think it's important to say that in some ways the intellectual history of Islam, certainly in the modern period, is not very distinguished. That's to say, there has been a reluctance amongst many intellectuals, until quite recently, to argue against the power of the church, so to speak, over people's lives. There has not been a kind of secularizing enlightenment moment in Islam. And that is what gives the fundamentalists a kind of rhetorical force that has very little, that is very difficult to counter with equal force. Now, I think, there is, in the last blessing now, I mean, let's say in the last half century, in the post-colonial period in the Muslim world, there has been, we do see the emergence of a very courageous intellectual movement which demands a kind of secularization of those societies. And I would say that those people have been, for example, very courageous in my defense. You know, people from Egypt or from the Muslim countries of North Africa or even from Iran, and from Muslim countries around the world, many people have spoken out in my defense because they see it also as speaking out in their own defense. And repeatedly, you hear from Muslim intellectuals around the world that the reason Rushdie must be supported is that to support Rushdie is to support us. You know, and that if that battle is lost, then we have no chance. If that battle is won, then it's one step in the bigger war. You know, and certainly I feel that, and I find many of these writers to be more or less heroic figures, because after all they're living amongst the enemy, so to speak. You know, and if you look at what's been happening in Algeria, it shows how dangerous that is. In Algeria, in recent years, the fundamentalist murderers have deliberately targeted writers, journalists, and intellectuals for assassination. And because, in fact, they are afraid of the people who have the ability, through language, to offer the people a different view of the world. And so there have been, I think more than 50 writers and journalists and intellectuals murdered in Algeria in the last 2 years, including some of the country's most important figures, the novelist Dara Djellit, for example. So there is now, I feel, after a long period in which intellectuals in these countries did not speak out against the forces of fundamentalism, but there is now a genuine movement, I think. And unfortunately, this movement gets very little attention in the rest of the world, and that makes it weaker. In the way that when the Soviet Union was in existence, the interests of the West were to highlight the writers who spoke out against the Soviet system and who gave very important testimony against it. And those dissident writers, we quite rightly, in my view, treated as very important historical figures. I think that there is now a dissident movement of equal importance that is taking shape inside these countries. And unfortunately, it does not seem to be, the West does not seem to be so interested in highlighting that movement, perhaps because of oil, some other such consideration. But I do think that what is happening there in Algeria, in Egypt, and in the Iranian emigration, that writers and intellectuals are finally beginning to say that there must be a kind of modern transformation in these societies. And this is a battle being fought more or less to the death. And there have been many casualties.
Thank you. Adriana Valdez,
I have been quite fascinated throughout this talk by you as a reader. And I would like to go back on that, perhaps thinking about people who are writing in English and who are not English. But there are many people that come from many different countries that are now writing in English. And in your own novels, you are always bringing up this question of multiplicity of cultures, and even using a word such as mongrel to describe that. And I would like to, I'm mentioning only three writers because they have been translated into Spanish, but it's a very haphazard also, a very haphazard list. But I would be very interested in your commenting either on them or on any other writers that are significant to you in this perspective. I was thinking of Derek Walcott, I was thinking of Ishiguro, I was thinking of Vikram Seth.
Well, very different writers, but I think the general point is quite right, that one of the most interesting developments in contemporary English language literature is the, I suppose you could call it, the consequences of English having become the world's language. So that the literature of English becomes the literature of the English language rather than the literature of England. And of course this is in one sense not new. Previously American English broke away, so to speak, from the main body of English literature and established itself as an independent literature of great strength in its own right. Irish literature, you could say, had done the same thing, although the links between Irish literature and the mainstream of English literature remain closer. And now there are these so-called new English literatures. And certainly, I have a personal bias being a member of these literatures and in generally in their favor. I do think that the writers you mentioned are unusually interesting to me. I'm a great admirer of Walcott's poetry. I feel that he is a member of a kind of group of great poets who seem to be, in a way, almost deliberately, in the way of Braque and Picasso sometimes, working in a similar vein. So if you look at Walcott and Joseph Brodsky, Seamus Heaney, that you see a kind of almost a collective enterprise, you know, drawn from very different cultural roots and so on. But how would one characterize that? One would characterize it, I think, they're all very interested in the classics. So there is an enormous wealth of classical allusion and reference in Walcott's poetry, as there is in Brodsky's and as there is in Heaney's and so on. They're also public writers, so that they quite consciously take on public themes in their work. They have, all of them, quite strong mythological inclinations. So, I mean, Walcott, of course, primarily in the great Omeros poem. They use language rhythms which come from various parts of the world and translate them into English. You know, Walcott has sometimes been criticized in the Caribbean because he does not make more use of what is sometimes called Creole and sometimes called Patois, and in the politically correct parlance is called nation language. I think that Walcott, when he uses those rhythms of Caribbean English, does so beautifully because he does so with restraint, and uses them when they are necessary and not when they're not. And I think in very similar ways, Heaney's Irish and Brodsky's curious kind of post-Nabokovian Russian English is another way of bringing that kind of other music language. So I think it's very interesting. It will be very interesting to look at the works of these poets, you know, collectively, in the way in which one can hang Braque's and Picasso's of a certain period side by side, and examine them in that way. Ishiguro, who is a close personal friend of mine, so I sort of just say that to bone up for Tobias, but and he's rather a different case in a way, because although he was born in Japan, first of all, he doesn't have this kind of post-colonial aspect, because of course Japan was never a part of the British Empire, and as somebody said to me yesterday, Britain is now in the process of becoming a part of the Japanese Empire. But he of course came to England when he was very, very small, and really has, as he says, he has the Japanese of a seven-year-old boy, because that was, you know, how old he was when he stopped living in Japan. So he has grown up really in England as an English child who looks different, and has. But what was interesting to me was that in his early books, he, and his early stories, he found his voice as a writer really by going in his imagination into the Japan in which he had not really lived. So that his first novel was about his hometown of Nagasaki in the aftermath of his great bomb, even though he didn't remember it. His second novel was about the compromises, if you like, intellectual compromises made by certain Japanese thinkers and writers during the Second World War, and the consequences of that afterwards. And I think in many ways that novel, Analysis to the Floating World, is his finest novel. And his more famous novel, which was made into a movie and so on, The Remains of the Day, is a kind of English rewrite of that novel, you know, in which once again you have a figure who is compromised by his associations in the war, and the consequences of that, but transposed, if you like, into the English class system and out of the Japanese class system. I think he's a writer at the moment in the process of metamorphosing into another very strange sort of writer. His new novel has probably not yet been published in Spanish, has it? The English title is The Unconsoled, in which it's a complete departure from his previous work. It's a very long novel, it's more than 500 pages long, and completely surrealist in its technique, it has been called Kafkaesque, and it appears to be a kind of voyage around a man's unconscious, and it uses techniques of dream and of the study of the unconscious, which are very interesting and often very, very difficult to follow. It's a book that has had a very mixed reception, partly because people were so shocked at the departure from his previous books, and partly because he's trying to do something very complex, and I think some people were unable to stay interested. But I think these are colossally interesting writers because they're adventurous and because they are not stuck in the Englishness of England. I mean, Vikram Seth, I think, is a different case in that I think he's a much more conventional writer. I think that there is really very little in his novel, in his immense novel, Suitable Boy. There's very little in the way of innovation in that book. There's a great deal in the way of social detail and charm and anecdote and incident and so on. But I think he's a rather old-fashioned writer in a way, whose interest is in the kind of roman fleuve that were popular a long time ago, at least in that book it is. Also, Vikram is in a way much more rooted in India than or in his original country, let's say, than the other writers you mentioned. Although he has spent time in the West, he is very much to be seen as an Indian writer from India, I think. Well, it is true that The Suitable Boy was not that well received in India. It was very well received everywhere else. And I think the problem, a problem, is that the book succeeds because of its very detailed portrait, very detailed naturalistic portrait of the world. Now, if that happens to be the world in which you're already living, you don't see the need for the naturalistic portrait of it, because it's outside the window. why take a photograph when you can look out the window? So I think, in a way, the book has a great interest and value, I think, for people who do not know India, because it really will tell you, what an Indian wedding is like, or if you wanted to go to an Indian religious festival, these are the things that would happen, and here is how the caste system works, and these are the various relationships between the different communities. So, I mean, if you want to know that stuff about India, then it is a very vivid and charming way of getting that information. In India, of course, people know that stuff. And they're looking for something else, I guess.
Well, I would like to... voy a explicar lo que va a ocurrir ahora. Vamos a tener la oportunidad para que firme libros en un tiempo corto. Pero antes de eso creo que es bueno darle a Solman la última palabra.
Well, I would only want to say that it's very good to finally have arrived. It's taken us a couple of days. But it is, not to dwell on the past, it feels finally that I have been able to do a little of what I came here to do, which is to be able to talk with people and have a little sense of the place that I'm in. And so, I'm grateful to you all for coming and making that possible for me. As regards the politics of the situation, I mean, I must tell you that I have somewhat lost interest in the politics of the situation. I hope that things are gradually improving, I hope they will continue to improve, so that next time I come to Chile, we will not have this strange situation in which there are more people outside the building than there are inside. let's say next time, I hope, without this kind of police, the necessity for this police operation. And finally, just to say what a pleasure it is to be able to come here you know, not as a kind of imaginary being, but as a writer amongst colleagues, and to be able to talk about something serious like books. Thank you very much.
Agradecer a Arturo Infante de la Editorial Sudamericana y Clásica 3, a Carlos Franz de la Feria del Libro, a las Fuerzas de Seguridad por la colaboración prestada y desde luego a